Good morning, and welcome to the Veterans Showcase. I'd like to thank you for taking your time out of your day to tune in and listen to what I have to inform you with today. I'd also like to thank BCTV for allowing me this time and opportunity to be on the show. First subject I want to talk about is the Camp Lejeune, the contaminated water that was down there. Many people know that the water was contaminated between January 1st, 1953 and December 31st of 1987. That's the portion of the law that allows there's 15 health conditions that are related to the contaminated water that people were exposed to while being stationed at Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. So if you're there for a minimum of 30 days stationed there for any reason whatsoever, you can file for health care benefits right now. And there's 15 conditions that it's covered, and I don't know all of them right offhand, but you can go to va.gov, type in Camp Lejeune contaminated water, and that presumptive list will come up. One of them is that I know of right off the top of my head is kidney cancer and liver cancer. So if you're experiencing that and you were stationed down at Camp Lejeune during that time period, you can definitely file for health care through the VA. And if it's proven that you were there at that time, then the VA is obligated to take care of those conditions at no cost to you. Now, a lot of people want to talk about their dependents that were there with them. Okay, so if your spouse and your children were stationed there with you and they have the same conditions as what's on the presumptive list, you can file for medical reimbursement, out-of-pocket medical reimbursement. That's for co-pays, prescription drugs, anything that covers those one of those 15 15 presumptive conditions. Now, Congress did pass that into law quite a while ago, I believe it was in 2012, but compensation didn't come with it. Today, well, just recently, VA Secretary McDonald has proposed to make those service-connected conditions, meaning that if you have, there's a certain list, and it's not all 15 conditions, but it's a big list that if you have one of those conditions or you're experiencing more than one of those conditions, you can file for compensation. Now, it's still being proposed. There's a big time frame that has to do with this too, public hearings, testimony of the Congress. Congress has to rewrite the laws, and then it has to be signed into law. So it's going to take a little while before they can get this through, but that's just to let you know that Secretary McDonald is proposing this change in law. Now, I always tell, whenever I see a veteran that comes in and they have any of these conditions, yes, I definitely file for the health care enrollment because of these, and then I also file for compensation. Now, I explain to the veteran that it's not written into law yet, so it may be service-connected and it may not be. If it's not, it's because the doctors in Kentucky, because all the claims for Camp Lejeune go to Kentucky to be decided. They're not down in Philadelphia. It's all sent to Kentucky. They have subject matter experts in that area that know Camp Lejeune very well, and they have doctors that know the etiologies of the conditions that you're experiencing right now and how they relate to the contaminated water. So don't be disappointed if it comes back and it's denied. We can look at that as this law is being changed. So with that, I just want to make sure that everybody knows that is in the works right now. It's being proposed for compensation. So as time goes on, I will continue to talk about this because it's a very important matter to a lot of people. It's very important to the Berks County Veterans Service Center, too. And we want to make sure that all veterans of Berks County are receiving all their benefits that they're eligible for. The second topic I want to talk about is our crosstalks. Every second Wednesday of the month, we hold a crosstalk in our conference room. And it's been going on for 4 years now. And we're asking you, anyone, to come on out and share with us. What's the crosstalk? What it's all about? It's local resources that come together and we discuss matters at hand. What does this service offer? What do these services offer? What do we offer? What can we do to help this veteran and this spouse and this family member? You know, so it's a bunch of agencies getting together and knowing who does what, so that way if you come to see one of us, we know exactly who to turn to and how to help you out, seek those benefits, find those benefits that you're seeking. Every second Wednesday of the month we have a crosstalk in our office. It's at 726 Cherry Street. You can call 610-378-5601 and find out more about the crosstalk and when's the next one, what's the date of the next one. Parking is at no cost. We have a parking ramp that's in the BARTA bus station, and you can definitely come on down and we'll open up the gate for you so you can come in and park at no cost. Please come on out to our crosstalk. Everyone is invited. We really encourage veteran service organizations of the local area to come on out and talk. Another benefit I'd like to talk about, if we keep the screen up just for a little bit longer, is our benefits briefings. They're every Tuesday at 1:30 in the afternoon. This covers the plethora of benefits that the VA offers. We go from compensation to pension to healthcare to burial. And it lasts usually about an hour and a half to 2 hours, but it's a very informative, and this way it gives you a better idea of what you're going to file for, or what kind of benefits that you've earned and what you want to apply for. And we're there to assist you with all those benefits, all those applications. We're not the people who administer the programs, but we're the people who can help you go through the maze that to get to that benefit, to apply for and understand those benefits and how the process works. And speaking of the process, what I'd like to do today is talk about how the VA claims process works. But before I do, I'd like to show, it's a 4-minute video. It talks about actually filing the claim, how it works out, what is needed. And it's done by a legal aid office done in Kentucky. Speaking of Kentucky, Camp Lejeune, when I was reviewing it, I thought it was pretty well laid out and pretty explains pretty much everything. So if we could go to the video screen here, and I'll play this 4-minute video for you.
Branch of the United States Armed Services and have a current medical condition, you could be eligible for VA disability compensation benefits. While it is best to file for benefits either as soon as you get out of the military or as soon as the condition occurs, there are no time limits or deadlines for when you have to file your first claim. Therefore, you may file for VA disability compensation benefits at any time for any condition that you reasonably believe was caused or aggravated by your service. The initial filing of a VA benefits claim is relatively simple. You may either file the forms for yourself, or you can get help from a local veteran service organization or from your state's Veterans Affairs Office. You should know that at this stage, you are not allowed to pay anyone to represent you with your claim. Before you file your initial claim, you'll need to understand the basic requirements. First, you'll need eligible military service. You must have done military service, and you must have a discharge that is other than dishonorable. If your discharge is other than honorable, but not dishonorable, you may be qualified for a more restricted range of benefits. You will also need a current condition. You must have a current injury or illness that can be connected to your military service. This means that you should have a fairly clear medical diagnosis. It should be stated in a medical record prepared by a qualified healthcare provider, preferably a doctor. The more precisely defined the condition is in the record, the better. You'll also need an event in service. You must have had an event in service that you reasonably believe was the cause for your current illness. You will need to give the VA written evidence of this event. The best evidence is an event that is recorded in a service medical record. This is a detailed description of the cause of the injury or illness leading to your condition, how it was treated, and any residual effects of the event. If there is no military record of this event, you can get buddy testimony, that is, a written statement from someone who witnessed the event to support your claim. If the condition is related to a non-combat event, you will need documentation of the following. A clear service connection. Your medical evidence must be clear enough to prove that your current condition is connected to the in-service event. This is called service connection, or a nexus. If you can't prove the service connection, you will not receive benefits. Now that you know the requirements for VA disability benefits, you should file your forms as soon as you decide you have a reasonable claim. This is important because your filing date sets the start date of your award. You do not need to gather all the supporting evidence before filing your claim. You can even submit your evidence after you file. Waiting until you get every last piece of evidence only costs you money. The VA will pay you only from the date of the claim, no matter when the condition began. The VA form you will need to file is called the 21-526. You can print out this form from the VA's website, or you can e-file it online. Whichever option you choose, remember to keep a copy of the claim you submitted. Keeping records of all your dealings with the VA is in your best interest. If you choose to print the form out, you will then need to mail it to the VA regional office in the state where you live. If your state has more than one, mail it to the closest VA RO in your state. The VA claims process can be slow and frustrating. Although the VA has a duty to assist you with your claim, you should remember that this is a legal proceeding and that you should be ready to prove every part of your claim. You are much more likely to be successful if you can organize your information and keep good records of your interactions with the VA. If you have trouble with these kinds of tasks, you may want to seek help from a VSO or your state's Veterans Affairs Office. For more information on how to file for your initial VA disability benefits claim, visit www.statesidelegal.org or www.va.gov.
Okay, so that was a good, very good video. And one of the other things that you could visit is our website at County of Berks. .com. You can Google us, you can make an appointment on there, you can email us everything that you want to talk to us about. So, or you can email us at veterans@countyofberks.com. Again, and you can call us too at 610-378-5601 to make an appointment to visit with us. Now the video, what it pointed out was that no one helping you with your claim can charge you, okay? So by using the Berks County Veterans Service Office, we will help you. We will do the application with you, okay? So, and we will not charge you at all while doing this process. So the best thing to do is you can, like he said, you can do it online at va.gov, or you can go to ebenefits.gov. Or you can visit our office, and we will assist you with creating that application and completing that application. Because the biggest thing you really want to make sure is that you're submitting all the evidence up front. Now, in the video it said you want to file it right away because you don't want to lose that protective date or the effective date, which is very true. But what we do in our office, we do a little bit different. We will file an intent to file. It's on a standardized form that the VA is now requires. And you can Google that form also. It's a VA form 21-0966, and it's called intent to file. With that form, you don't label any of the conditions that you want to file for. You're only saying that you want to file a claim, either for compensation or pension or dependency and indemnity compensation. With that said, what that does is once you mail that into the VA, you're just telling the VA, hey, I'm going to file a claim. And that from that date forward, you have 1 year to actually file the fully developed claim, giving you time to develop that claim, making sure that you have that proof, such as what the video stated. Okay? Because you have to remember that the burden of the proof is on the veteran. One of the biggest things I always tell people is that if the person in the military didn't document that medical condition that happened, we really can't blame the VA for that. Because the VA employee down in Philadelphia, they're not the ones that should have documented that condition in your military records. It should have been that person who was responsible for it in the military. I'm not saying that the veteran was responsible for documenting that in the military, but I'm just saying that it should have been done in the military. So, and if it wasn't, then it's really hard to prove. But like the video states, if you have a current doctor and you're doctoring, okay, the video states that you had to have an incident in service, had to have had a chronic diagnosis while in service. Well, that's true according to law, but it doesn't have to be really a chronic condition. It could be an acute condition. And then after you get out of the military, you have to show a continuity of health services for that condition. That helps build your claim up also. So like say, I always use the left knee as a condition to explain stuff. So you strained your knee in the service. Well, you've seen the doctor, and they gave you an ACE bandage, or they gave you some Motrin, and that's your last complaint of it in the service. But the day you got out, you started seeing a doctor. 30 years later, you continue to see a doctor every year, every 6 months about this condition, and next thing you know, you have knee surgery. Well, that continuity of service, showing the complaints of that condition, will definitely prove to the VA that that incident is related to your service. And that's the nexus part of it. That's that link, that bridge between your military service and today. You have to have that bridge going back and forth. Okay? So with that, with all of that, that's the one thing we do in our office is we make sure that your claim is fully developed, such as in a fully developed claim process. We make sure it's fully developed because with that said, we have seen success in our office. We've seen claims come back in 14 days to 120 days. Now, the Philadelphia regional office of down in Philadelphia, their claim process is averaging 168 days right now. But like I said, in our office, we're seeing claims come back in 120 days. Now, that's not saying that everybody's claim is going to come back in less than 120 days, because it depends on the complexity of the claims, the conditions that you're submitting for. TBI is definitely a complex claim. PTSD is a complex claim. They're not cut and dry, and the VA has to figure out, first of all, is this service-connected? And you have to prove, is it service-connected? Now, having a medal, an award, such as the Purple Heart, the Bronze Star with Valor, the Silver Star, Congressional Medal of Honor, awards such as this prove for PTSD that an incident already occurred in the military. So with that, it's easier to prove that. Now, if you have a incident in service where it's non-combat, then it's the development is a little bit more time and effort on your part, and that's where it's very complex, is because now the VA has to determine if it is in service, is this current mental health issue related to that incident in service, and then more than likely a doctor's opinion is gonna have to provide that nexus, because you and I, if you're not a doctor, if you're not a practicing doctor right now, you and I are not qualified to make that decision. It's got to be someone who's got the credentials of a medical provider, a medical doctor. Nurse practitioners are good. Physician assistants are good. Social workers can get the ball rolling for you. Okay, so you got to remember that if there's got to be an event in service for service connection. Just because you were in a car accident, you know, sorry to hear that you were in a car accident, you know, many years after the service, that's not related to your military. So it's gotta be related to your military. Think of VA compensation as the same as workers' compensation. It's gotta happen while you're in the military. If it didn't happen while you're in the military, then it doesn't qualify for VA compensation. Now, it might qualify for VA pension, but that's another story. That's another segment we'll cover on. And so just remember, the intent to file, that is the biggest thing. So if you come see me and I say, okay, we're going to file an intent to file today, that's mainly telling you, and I will explain that to you, that we don't have everything here for the VA employee down in Philadelphia. Now, there's nothing wrong with the intent to file. I want to make sure everyone's fully aware of that. And then in the video, it said mailing stuff down to the local RO. If you can avoid that, that's even better because it's too long. So if you come to our office, we'll get it faxed in. It'll be in the VA system within a matter of hours and 3 days max. So with that, I want to thank you for tuning in to BCTV and the Veterans Showcase today. And I hope to see you next month. And with that, take care and thanks again. And thank you for your service.